going to Germany with the college group there. And so I did at age 16, my brother and I, we saved up all of our money from babysitting. I kid you not, a dollar an hour back then, you know, walking beans for our uncles on their farms and other odd jobs that we had. And we went off to Germany for 3 weeks. Part of that excursion was literally going through Soviet checkpoints along the East German-West German border at Checkpoint Charlie into East Berlin. And that experience really, you know, when you don't, if you haven't gone through that, it sets your mind on what does freedom mean. And your generation really has no recollection of that. Your generation can only read about it in a history book. Your generation can't actually experience that. It's very hard to experience that. So going from there, I mean, to me, it was pretty instrumental then to see Ronald Reagan elected. And then I made the decision to go to West Point under his time frame. I wanted to go. I wanted to serve. I was very much interested in the military and thought at some point that I would make it a military career. And then I had my first child and that all went out the door. But, you know, I then was stationed in Germany. Although I studied. Serve in a combat zone. Back then, there was really no combat zone to serve in. However, people wanted to be in Germany, where we felt expected a Soviet, you know, land war coming across the Fulda Gap. So I went to Germany, and I was fortunate enough to be there in 1989 when the wall came down. So for me, Ronald Reagan means the fruition of leadership. When you don't just speak it, you actually put action behind that. And so, you know, he'll always be one of my favorite presidents, obviously. And so I'm really grateful for YAF to come here. And it's remarkable that, you know, 40 years after Ronald Reagan's taking office, he's created really a movement. So I applaud you guys for being here. So I think most of you guys are you guys from kind of local? Who's from Wisconsin? Okay, who's from Illinois? All right. And then we have a handful of people that are from elsewhere. Is that true? Okay, great, good. Well, welcome. So Illinois is a mess. Politically, financially, it's a mess. No matter what the commercials say, Illinois is a financial mess. Just want to set the tenor there. But it's actually what I'm going to talk about today. Things are a mess everywhere. And I love this theme of American exceptionalism, and I want to add something to that. Don Willett in the Wall Street Journal in September of 2018 wrote an opinion piece. And in that opinion piece, he made this statement, which I think is entirely true. Citizenship is not a spectator sport. If we don't get involved in politics, politics will get us involved anyway. So if you don't get involved in your school boards, the school boards are going to take over your kids' life anyway. So this is really important for you guys to remember. You can't just hide your head in the sand. It doesn't work that way. And, you know, the other thing that also comes to mind is what Thomas Jefferson said. Whenever the people are well informed, they can be trusted with their own government. So it takes two of them. First of all, we have to be well-informed citizens, but then we actually have to get involved. We can't just sit on the sidelines and expect that it's somebody else's responsibility. And I don't think that we're going to get that. You guys would not be here at YAF if you felt that it was just something for somebody else to take care of. I love the fact that you're interested in politics. I was interested in politics. I was a teenage Republican serving on our state committee when I was in high school myself. So I think this is great that you're here. I also want to give a shout out to my niece, Annalise, who is graduating from the University of Alabama this weekend. And she is on the YAF executive team there. So, you know, it's kind of filtered down. And she grew up in Vermilion, South Dakota, too, had a pretty much all scholarships at Alabama, and then she joined YAF. So the tradition continues everywhere. And that's the beauty of what you guys have started here, what YAF has started, what Ronald Reagan started, and that's that you are, actually investing in are the next generation who's going to have to solve some of these problems. And so I thought that my speech today would be mainly about to preserve America, conservatives must speak up and work locally. And so a little bit about me. I am a mother of five children. I got out of the Army after I was pregnant with my number two, knowing that I wanted to stay home and take care of them. But you know what? I kept watching what was going on. And when the time was right, I looked at a friend, and he's like, "You should run for Wheaton City Council." Okay, because I was complaining about this and that, and some tax hikes and stuff like that. So I started to get involved on Wheaton City Council level. And then one thing led to another, and I took on some tax issues, and the business community kind of knew about that. And what happened is there became an open seat, and this was in 2012, right after redistricting. And so I ran for state rep. And so I went from Wheaton City Council to state representative. And then in 2018, I ran for governor against a incumbent Republican billionaire who had betrayed everything that Republicans stood for. So we kind of took on that fight in 2018. If you're from Illinois, maybe your parents are aware of that fight. It was a big fight. It was a lot of fun. Definitely my favorite race so far. After that, I was then out of office as well in January 2019. And a long-serving state congressman, Peter Roskam, had lost his seat. And somebody had to take on Sean Casten, who is one of the most partisan Democrats out there. Even his own party doesn't like him. And I'm not going to get too political. I'm just laying the land here, the landscape. And so we ran that race. It was, when we started, we did feel it was a very winnable race, but it was going to be a little bit of an uphill climb. And then what happened? COVID hit, the George Floyd stuff hit, the riots hit, you know, things were off the rails. And we ended up losing by a small percentage. And I looked at that and I said to myself, you know, I don't really think the people like the policies that these guys are pushing. I think that people just don't know what they don't know. And so I started something along with my communications director, a group called Breakthrough Ideas. And Breakthrough Ideas is about connecting the dots for local voters on any type of issues. Schools, what's going on in schools, tax increases, energy policy, things that affect them. And this is where I'm working today. I'm the CEO for Breakthrough-Ideas. We're a 501c4, and we operate mainly in the suburbs to connect the dots because there's a lot of information gap. And you guys are actually, honestly, you're more informed than many of the adults that are going to vote in this year's election. So I give you credit for that. But in doing this, I'll tell you what, the last 2 years have been a wake-up call for everybody. And so I know that I am looking at the next generation of leaders in right here in this room, whether it's local, state, or national level. But every generation must deal with the legacy of the past generations. And as just a simple observer of how I grew up, what I've been involved in over the last decade in politics, I specifically think that the last 2 years that your generation has significant challenges ahead of you. And I'm going to apologize right up for that, although I feel like I've done my part. Believe me, there are many of us whose kids are entering young adulthood and becoming first-time parents that will be taking on the fight with you, will be there with you for as long as we are on this earth. There are parents across the nation that now have more understanding of what has happened on their watch, and now they are energized to fix it. But many of these problems will persist, and it will be up to your generation to take a stand on. I believe personally that the last 2 years have been two of the most consequential years in the 21st century, for sure, if not in the last 50 years. And the mark will be felt on generations long into the future. And well, what do I mean about that? Well, let's start about this first. First, the expertise class, they've been wrong. They've been wrong about just about everything in the last 2 years. They were wrong about COVID. They were wrong about Russian collusion. They botched the Afghanistan withdrawal. Corporate and government elites continue to scare people unnecessarily about climate change, which endangers our way of life. The media has lied to all of us. Tech giants censored speech. Elections were fraudulently conducted, and I know about that firsthand. But more than anything else, the elites from academia to your local school are attempting to indoctrinate you and your classmates. But let's start with COVID. 30 days to flatten the curve became months of masking, lockdowns, remote learning, experimental vaccines, and in the end, little difference in slowing the spread or flattening the curve. Experts disagreed initially on the origins of coronavirus, some saying it occurred naturally, others saying it was man-made. The medical field first went to harsh treatments using ventilators, experimental drugs, and then experimental vaccines. Meanwhile, they ignored testing drugs with a track record of being safe. They ignored the Barrington Declaration, which was authored by three prominent epidemiologists, and they published just months after the beginning of the lockdowns, that argued for focused protection of the most vulnerable and a common sense approach to treating the virus using already known therapies. The experts also refused to use their bully pulpit to talk about taking vitamins, getting fresh air, and maintaining health weight as natural ways to help virus prevention and recovery. To be clear, thousands, if not millions of people did die around the world from the virus. I'm not disputing that. The issue is the prescriptions issued by the knowledge class proved to not make much difference and in some cases created harm. In the last week, over 78% of the COVID deaths were breakthrough deaths in Illinois. These are deaths of fully vaccinated individuals. In the last 10 weeks in Illinois, 7 of the weeks registered more who died from COVID who were fully vaxxed than those who were partially or unvaxxed. So the expertise class has let us down. Wall Street Journal reported, and these were about the lockdowns specifically, and quoting from that, the authors are University of Chicago economists Casey Mulligan and Stephen Moore and Phil Kirpin of the Committee to Unleash Prosperity. They compare COVID outcomes in the 50 states and D.C. based on three variables, the economy, education, and mortality. The study that belies much of the conventional medical and media wisdom during the pandemic, especially in its first year when severe lockdowns were described as the best and only moral policy. But that's not what happened, right? Florida did about average on mortality as other states, but it did far better in protecting its citizens from severe economic harm and its children from lost schooling. The correlation between health and economy scores is essentially zero, say the authors, which suggests that states that withdrew the most from economic activity did not significantly improve health by doing so. The data, straight without policy and conclusion, is basically this. The severe lockdown states suffered much more on overall social well-being in return for relatively little comparative benefit on health. Aren't we glad we live in a federalist system? Aren't we glad that we have laboratories of democracy in every one of our states? But let's recognize this for what it was. It was a failure of the experts in one of the most damaging situations that has happened to our nation in a long time. On schools, though, right? We masked healthy kids. You guys know about this, including two-year-olds. We ushered in remote learning that was a disaster and created mental health issues. We required unnecessary testing and pushed experimental vaccines on children. In Illinois, the results of these policies were shown to be a drop in enrollment, mostly pre-K through kindergartner, a significant increase in absenteeism, and the number of students meeting grade level standards dropped 17.8% in math and 16.6% in English language arts, with the biggest declines seen among English language learners and low-income students. So those least able to weather the storm of remote learning were the most impacted, and yet the experts kept it up. In the state of Illinois, some schools just became unmasked recently. But where else have we witnessed sort of this expertise class failing you? Well, national security agencies got involved in the presidential election. During the 2016, high government officials spied on the Trump campaign and leaked information about the bogus investigation to the media, who printed it without proper vetting. Only in the last 2 years have people begun to be indicted over this. This malfeasance has led Americans to rightfully distrust our government. Then you have media censorship. In 2020, near the end of the campaign, mainstream media blocked the information about Hunter Biden's laptop and the information on it that shows his cozy financial relationships with China and implicates Joe Biden in those relationships. The result of this, as many as 17% of those who voted for Democrat Joe Biden might have chosen differently at the polls had they been given fair media coverage of the candidates in the weeks leading up to the election. That's according to a report. And then you've got unprecedented government spending, which is really going to be impactful for you and your generation. Government spending from 2020 to 2021 is unprecedented. In 2019, the national debt was around $22.7 trillion. In 2022, the national debt is nearly $30 trillion and is historic in that it exceeds our gross domestic product. And that hasn't happened since World War II. Additionally, military confidence is slipping, according to survey results in the 10 months of the Biden administration. Respondents who said they trusted the military a great deal fell 11 points, the sharpest single-year decline since the survey began. Political leadership was the top reason listed for the decline in confidence. And for me, that's a little bit concerning. As Gianna said, my oldest was an Army Ranger. His path to that position was first an ROTC scholarship at the University of Illinois, where he studied electrical engineering. He then went through Ranger School and served up in Alaska. He is now out and getting his MBA at University of Chicago. My second son, Nick, went to West Point, and he's a little bit of a traitor. He cross-commissioned to the Navy after graduating, and he's a Navy pilot. So we're really proud of him, and he's about to deploy again in August. And then we have a third son, and then our fourth son, Joe, is at West Point. He's a sophomore there studying pre-med. So the politicization of the military is very concerning to me as a West Point graduate. My husband's also a West Point graduate. And then having our kids go and see what's going on at Joe frequently, he doesn't tell me so much anymore, told me about the wokeness and the training that he had to go through at West Point, and then I would always fire off an email, and so he stopped telling his mom what's going on so much. But he needs to tell me more. But let's look specifically at schools, which probably you guys can tell me a lot more about, and I hope that we have a conversation about that when I'm done with my remarks. But across the country and in private schools, woke ideology, including transgenderism, is rampant. In Illinois, here's just a few stories that I wanted to share with you. And this is over just the last 10 days. Just the last 10 days. Hinsdale Central High School has been allowing so-called furries to wear animal costumes at the school. According to photos posted by the DuPage Policy Journal. One photo posted on Facebook shows a freshman student wearing what resembles a monster mask. Sources tell the newspaper that the student believes she is not a human, but a cat. A fellow student who took the photo of the furry was given a detention. This is Hinsdale Central High School, for those who aren't in the suburbs of Illinois. This is actually one of the top public high schools in the state. It's one of the most wealthy districts in the state as well. And when I say it's one of the top schools, let's be honest here. In the state of Illinois, only one-third of the kids read or do math at grade level. Only one-third of the kids read or do math at grade level. In the city of Chicago, less than a quarter of the kids read or do math at grade level. We have a number of schools around the suburbs, Chicago, and downstate, where I can show you example after example where less than 15% of the kids read or do math at grade level. So when I say Hinsdale is one of the better schools, the truth is their percentage is less than 70% of the kids read or do math at grade level, and instead they have furries running around the halls. Here's another example. A Bolingbrook Middle School is instructing its teachers in how to be more pro-LGBT, demanding they stop using terms like boys and girls, use LGBT adult role models in their lessons, and put gay pride rainbow flags on their desks. That's according to emails and a 25-page PowerPoint presented Wednesday to Brooks Middle School teachers as part of paid in-service training. So taxpayers are going to indoctrinate and train teachers who then, push this onto their young students. This is a middle school again. All right. Okay, then you've got in a prominent middle school out in the western suburbs, which I will not mention, but you have what they call the Youth Online Survey. And that survey, and I put this down too low. I don't even know if I can read it here. It's too tiny. But essentially, that what I'm reading here is in the survey is the survey says this survey is not to be taken at home. This survey is not to be taken online. This survey is only to be conducted in the school. Well, why do you think that is? Because they don't want the parents to know what's in the survey. And of course, the survey is, here's one of the questions. Which of the following best describes you? Heterosexual, (straight), gay or lesbian, bisexual. I describe my sexual identity some other way. I'm not sure about my sexual identity. Questioning. I do not know what this question is asking. So those are your choices, all right? This is, again, middle school. Then they have, of course, the infamous gingerbread person. I don't know if you've seen this before, but it shows a gingerbread man, and then you can look it up all you want. This is the type of stuff that is also, this actually was a slide from a high school presentation in that same school district in the western suburbs. And then I don't want to put Joe on the spot, but Joe is a graduate of Lyons Township High School. And at Lyons Township High School, sophomore Heaven Washington has been expelled only days after she brutally attacked a freshman. A source at the school informed West Cook News of the expulsion. Washington was reportedly at school Thursday and Friday after the Wednesday incident, but we have not been able to corroborate that. Washington has been a vocal leader in the school's equity efforts. An accomplice who filmed the attack called the victim a racist blank B and heckled her while Washington punched her in the face several times before dragging her across the floor by her hair. The victim later sought medical attention in an area hospital. She will be undergoing surgery to repair her scalp and jaw. She has a hematoma as well. The school and police have not commented on whether the attack was race motivated, as previously reported in West Cook News. So as you can see, it's getting bad from the ideology to the racial stuff. I will tell you this, in our own, I'm from Wheaton. Wheaton's pretty much known for Wheaton College. They call themselves the Harvard of Christian colleges, very evangelical in feel. And I will tell you, they had a Panthers in Black presentation at my local middle school that is only six houses away. And this is middle school, and they actually, they have an all-Black club at this Wheaton Middle School, Blacks only allowed. And then they allowed the eighth graders to do a presentation to the rest of the middle school about how to treat Blacks and what is the proper way to use or not use the N-word. And I kid you not, 18 slides on this. And this is in middle school in Wheaton. And now I know they probably don't do crazy stuff like that up in Wisconsin. Maybe Illinois is just weird, but this is what you're getting, okay? So to attend public school, and in some cases private school, is to be confronted with new thoughts about what children need to learn and who's responsible for that learning. Because they no longer think that parents are in charge or that parents matter. They now think that they are solely the ones who are, and Joe Biden's made remarks about this as well, that it's not a parent's right and to understand what's going on in the schools. And that's actually why Glenn Youngkin won the Virginia race. I think most people understand what happened in Loudoun School was an alarming spectacle of wokeness that got shot down in that governor's race. So, but make no doubt about it, schools are indoctrination centers, from social emotional learning objectives to transgender ideology that requires all persons to adhere to it. Nothing could be a bigger lie. And in Illinois, we take it to a new level. They passed just last year comprehensive sex ed, which begins with gender ideology in kindergarten, and it gets much, much worse from there. And in fact, it would embarrass me to tell you which actually is in that that bill and what is required for their comprehensive sex ed program. A year ago, they passed legislation, and honestly, okay, yeah, I do watch Tucker Carlson. Okay, I mean, you probably figured that out, but he does some really good programming. And just earlier this week, he talked about two different states where they have feminine hygiene products in the boys' bathroom. And I'm like, that's old news. That is absolutely old news. And he mentioned, I think it was California, probably California, and Illinois. And I was like, Illinois passed that legislation like months ago. Last year, they passed that legislation. So now you have feminine products in boys' bathrooms mandated. It's mandated. If you have any in bathrooms where there's a fourth grader or higher is present, you must put feminine products in their boys' bathroom. This is how nuts they have gotten. And additionally, numerous teachers now circulate those getting to know you information forms that ask kids their pronouns. That happened to my daughter in high school this year. Of course, I fired off an email immediately. And then, of course, we have official guidance from the Illinois State Board of Education that all schools must allow any student to use the locker room or bathroom of their choice. The guidance also includes hiding information from parents on their own children's behavior in school. So if they want, and you've heard now that they've got actual gender changing closets where you can go in and take off your regular clothes. I mean, this is just idiotic, right? This is delusional. This is delusional. Any teacher who allowed a furry to walk through the Hinsdale High School hallway and didn't say, "What the hell's going on here?" Right? I mean, this is the problem, right? They're silenced. And it's frightening to me because I'm frightened for you. I don't think any kid should have to live with that kind of delusion. So that's how we go. So how do we get out of this? Which is really the title of my stuff, my talk. I mean, you know, conservatives must speak up. They must speak up at local meetings. That you have to run for office. You have to take back your local school boards, city councils, and then you have to move up from there and you have to run for higher office. There's no other solution. We don't solve this with armed conflict. It's not how we do that. But increasingly, what you're going to see is if you don't take it on in your own place, you cannot just always move away from it. You can't. We'd like to move to Tennessee. We'd like to maybe move to Texas, get away from it. But the truth is that it could follow you there. And in fact, much of this stuff is happening everywhere you go. So the only solution really is to get involved. Citizenship is not a spectator sport. An informed citizenry is the only way to preserve government, a democracy. And so we've got our work cut out for us because there are large and very powerful special interests working against us. But I think that a lot of that's unraveling. And so I am heartened by the change that I've seen. I'm heartened by the fact that Elon Musk bought Twitter. I think that's a good thing. It's great to see young people here that are interested and involved. And I, for myself, I plan to keep your parents as informed as possible through any of the work that I do. And so we put out a newsletter every week, and I think it shocks most of the readers with the stuff that we put out. They don't know what they don't know. And I would include things from energy policy. I mean, that's top right up there. You cannot run a modern economy on wind and solar. We need to have frank conversations about it. Fortunately, there's been converts to that cause. Michael Schellenberger, who's now running for California governor, was a huge climate alarmist until his daughter caught him one day, and she just seemed so worried about the future and the earth possibly burning up. And she's like, he had this revelation, this epiphany. What have I done to my child? And then he started really just turning the tide on it and talking about normal things that we can do and how it's not as bad as is. And if you do care about the climate issue, if you do care about right energy policy, even Michael Moore, who's far left progressive, did an incredible hour and a half movie on this particular topic. I encourage you to watch it. So I'm encouraged that as more information gets out there that we can turn the tide here in the United States. We have to turn the tide. Listen, we're still the beacon of hope for everyone across America. It's still like in the last decade, there's been 3 million black Africans come and take up residency in the United States. Why? Is it because we're a systemically racist country? No, that's not true. We are the land of opportunity and they know it. So I'm encouraged by that, but I want to take your questions on any of the stuff that we've discussed so far.
Thank you so much. If you have a question, please just line up here, and you can just step up to the mic.
Hi, my name is Maylee Luna. I go to Divine Savior Holy Angels Catholic School. And in January, we also had to take that survey, and a bunch of the parents found out about it and also found out about an equity-like survey the school's doing with a, like, for-profit company. Mm-hmm. And my school was quoted on calling them domestic terrorists, the parents. And my question to you is, how do we keep our parents, like, heartened to, like, want to change? Because I know a lot of the parents that were trying to fight it got very discouraged over that and don't want to fight anymore. So how do we help keep our parents involved?
Okay, that's a great question. And so when we started Breakthrough Ideas, some of the first issues we were taking on were school issues because all this started to really explode. And so the way that we kept the, kind of the fight going, and at first it was about masks. People just wanted these masks off. They wanted their kids back in school. So that was kind of the genesis of all this. And then from there, we started looking at test scores and equity issues where they just didn't make sense. But the way that this works is you have to have a core group of people that are committed to each other to go to the school boards, to get on some of these citizen advisory committees of the school boards or their finance committee, and to actually just have a friendship. And so we have a Telegram chat group. I'm in another chat, District 200 chat group on Facebook. And then sometimes we physically get together and just have a drink together and talk about what's going on. And then we show up at the school boards together. And we actually have a planning session the week before the school board meeting, like, what are we going to do? How are we going to tackle this? So they have to find camaraderie within themselves to beat this back. And then they have to prove it up with statistics and statistics. So the other thing that I knew was really important is for the broader community to get together and support other school districts taking on issues. So we started something called our adult speakeasies on Tuesday night. And we would get anywhere from 30 to 40 parents together. And as much as I wanted to talk about other stuff like energy policy, it all always came back to schools. They're a big deal. And so we would get other people from maybe St. Charles or Glen Ellen or Wheaton or Downers Grove or other parts. And we would just start to come together and just talk about these issues. And then, hey, what worked at your school board meeting? What are you looking into? What data do you have? And so you have to have that sort of community feeling, and then they won't feel like they're alone. And nobody should feel like they're alone on this. You are not alone. There are a lot of people who want to fight back. They don't know what to do. Form your own group in your own community and fight back and ask for the data and FOIA them. Use Freedom of Information Act, use Open Meetings Act, and learn how to do that. We do watchdog training, so people know are more familiar with that. So that's my suggestion.
Thank you so much. Fighting.
You're welcome.
Hi, my name is Eli Brown. I go to Covington Catholic High School. I was just wondering, the quote you said at the beginning, who is that quote from?
Citizenship is not a spectator sport.
Yeah.
Okay, the man's name is Don Willett, and he wrote it in a Wall Street Journal opinion piece in September of 2018.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Hi, my name is Kyle Wilhite. I'm homeschooled. I was wondering for you, there are a lot of people who are wanting to stand up, like you were saying, but are kind of scared to. Mm-hmm. Any sort of, I think it kind of comes down to a lot of people are just scared to be different or seem different. What would you advise to tell these people to help them try to get up into the...
Okay, so is this parents or is this children or who?
Just the general public, really.
Just general public. Yeah, absolutely. Well, you kind of have to want to take on the fight, and it is not for the shy person at all. But this is why having a group of people together with you and then having, I've been speaking extemporaneously for a long time. I used to do extemp in high school. But I still, when I go to my school board meetings, I write out my notes and I read my 3-minute speech to them. One, so that I stay on time. Two, so I cover everything. And three, because it's still nerve-wracking looking at these seven just people just staring at you. And you know that you're getting nothing through their thick heads and they won't respond to you. But by making that public statement, what we do and what others do is they watch it. So a lot of people are watching offline. But my thing is you got to get a group together. You got to know what you're saying. You can personalize it even better. And, we posted, I have a lot of podcast stuff too, but we actually pull out public speeches that people have made at school board meetings. And then we highlight them in my podcast. And, some of these people, they're just so real. You've seen them online, these Loudoun people. You got to care about it enough to get out of your comfort zone. And if we're not going to get out of our comfort zone, the left's going to win. That's the bottom line. Do you want them to win or not? It's a fight. We're in a war.
Yeah, right. We're thank at war. You.
Yep, thank you for your question.
I actually have two questions for you.
Okay.
But the first one is, we have a lot of really woke, crazy parents out there who actually really do believe that school should be the one teaching children about sex ed and a bunch of this weird stuff. What would you say to those parents who don't believe it's their place to tell their children what they should have?
That's an excellent question, because there are a ton of them. And, you know, they're still sitting in their own car with a mask on. You know, this is these people. It's like they're okay. I mean, they are. They are. And but they do. They believe it's the school's responsibility. They see every child as needing some sort of social emotional support from this system. And that's not the way it used to be. It used to be that you would have, you know, we've always had children who maybe did need some extra support. I am not denying that. Or had a behavioral issue or had a really broken family life. I understand that. We need to have some of that support there. But now the approach is that the system owns your child, and that your child is a victim in some way. And that the only way they're going to get better is by having these administrative supporters or these school psychologists wrap around themselves. Everybody needs to have a trusted adult in the system. I mean, that's literally what they say at our school board meetings. It comes right out of our superintendent's mouth. Well, I don't know. I don't know that I want a trusted adult in the school. My daughter's got plenty of trusted adults, right? So they're out there, but you have to remind them that, guess what? Here's the bottom line. They're not your children. They're not your children, woke parents. And it's not proper for you to think that the school should teach my fifth grader how to masturbate. And unfortunately, that's part of the National Sex Education Standards. It just is. So, I mean, that is where we're going in the state of Illinois. That's the problem. That, you know, just, you have to have more people stand up against these parents and basically remind them, I don't care what you think. If you want your child indoctrinated, go for it. But it is my child. It is my child, and you are there to just teach the fundamentals. So what's your second question?
So my second question is, this whole thing about critical race theory.
Yes.
From what I've seen and read, the majority of Black communities don't actually want that to be taught in schools, but school boards aren't listening to them. They're listening to white people. So what in their brain is making them think that white people know what's good for Black people?
Well, that's a great question. And maybe you should present it to a school board that is doing that. But I absolutely do agree with you about that, typically your wealthy liberal whites want to speak for the Black community, and yet they don't want to live among the Black community. They don't know about the Black community. They don't hang out with the Black community, and they want to do this. And then they want to treat them all as victims. And I don't understand that at all. But what I do understand is that if you get down to brass tacks, I mean, what you need to do is you need to look at those majority minority communities and understand whether or not these kids are getting educated. So, I mean, I have online some reference videos on how to find that in Illinois. If you want to find school data out, I can help you with that. But for the most part, you have to go back to fundamentals. Everybody in America is an American first. We don't do gender identity. It doesn't help anybody to be treated that way. It doesn't help to just move kids along without educating them. That's not useful at all. So I think you have to call them out. And here's what I actually wanted to remember to tell you. So it is impressive that the people that want to cry systemically racist for particular entities are the ones running the system. So if your system's systemically racist, who's been running the system? Right? Who's been running the system? You've been running the system. The left's been running the school system. And you're saying it's systemically racist? Well, you've been running. I look at these superintendents. Oh, you have an equity problem? You've been there for 10 years. Like, just throw it right back at them. You've been there for 10 years. Because I guarantee you there are good people. And I want to make sure people understand. There are good people out there that do public service. There absolutely are great teachers. I mean, I've been the beneficiary of great teachers. There's good administrators that want to do the right thing. They want us to stand up on their behalf. And when we highlighted Naperville School District, they had a trainer in, and actually the Federalist wrote articles about it. This got like national level attention. They had this trainer in that they paid her $1,000 a minute to basically preach racial inequities for their school system. And we're like, are you kidding me? You've got teachers that have been there for 28 years. Are you saying that this teacher has been racially, bigoted the entire time? And a teacher wrote me. She sent me an email. She's like, thank you for saying what you're saying, because, you know, I will tell you that any minority that comes into Naperville school system hit the jackpot. We bend over backwards to help them. We do everything possible to bring them along and bring them up to speed. Everything. They're given every support system they possibly can. And so you have to ask them, really? Systemically racist? Well, are you running the system, and how long have you been doing it that way? How dare you be systemically racist? I mean, I just would throw it back at them. Anyway, my
Thank
thoughts.
You.
Yep, you're welcome. Hi.
Hello, my name is Reagan. I'm from Homer Glen, Illinois. I used to go to Lockport Township High School, but I was homeschooled this year because I decided to leave.
Good for you. Good for your parents.
I still speak at the school board meetings because I am very passionate about the school, even though I don't go there anymore. Mm-hmm. I went in August, and then I went again in September. It was actually my birthday when I spoke to them, and they threw me out. I went
in. Well, congratulations. Did we get that on video?
It is on video.
Okay, terrific. Great. Why did you get thrown out?
I used the word, I started my speech saying that all of their meetings are a banquet for the uninspiring and a tabloid for the mediocre, and they were very offended by that, and they threw me out. I went back in.
I need your information. I want you on my podcast.
I went back in February. I did not speak. I spoke again in March. I spoke in April, and I plan to speak in May. My April meeting was the first meeting that I ever got a contact back. They have not called me in all the meetings that I've been there, and the one time that they did call me was when I was complaining about the books that they have in their library, mm-hmm. which is the least passionate topic that I am about.
Right.
It figures that that's the one that they would respond to. Mm-hmm. But I did not get a call from the superintendent. I got a call from the soon-to-be assistant superintendent, which I don't even know what mm-hmm. that means. My question is, how do we hold the school board accountable? Because I've been going to the meetings for 8 months, and this is the first call I've gotten back, and the actual superintendent or any of the school board members won't speak to me. So
did you go to Lockport High School? Or
it was, Lockport Township High School.
Lockport Township High School. Okay, go ahead. So your question is?
My question is, how do we hold them accountable? How do we... I've been going for 8 months. This is the first call I've gotten back. And mm-hmm. I do belong to a group in Homer that does, we all go together. And
awesome. That's terrific.
Meetings outside of the school board. And we talk about how the meeting went and what we're going to do next time. So they're still not responding. We've given them FOIAs, and we've had multiple people request, legal information and ask what are the these private sessions that aren't disclosed. And they don't answer our questions. They don't answer through emails or private phone calls. They don't do it directly. Is there a way to force them to do a public Q&A where I go to them and I say, what is this about? No. And they answer.
No, there's no way to force them to do that. And we have no recall of elected officials in the state of Illinois unless you're the governor. And even then, that's nearly impossible to do unless you're somebody like Blagojevich and Madigan wants you out. So you're stuck here. I will say this, your school's not that bad. Prior to COVID, your high school had 41% read at grade level and 40% were proficient in math. That's prior to COVID. You've probably dropped a little bit from there. So mm-hmm. Actually better than the average.
It was top 1500 in the nation
for
a while.
Yeah. So not terrible, but still not killing it, right?
And it's also a very big high school. So when you take a very big percentage of, anyone, mm-hmm. your percentages tend to be higher because the proportionates are different. I mean, that's just simple statistics.
Right. When you look to Black population, only 2% read at grade level and do math at grade level. So mm-hmm. why don't you talk to them about that?
Well, they just added another, it's called Math Plus and Science Plus. In addition to the class that they added this year, which was Compass, they now have three additional classes for students whose grades dropped during COVID, and they still see no problem with their curriculum. They just think mm-hmm. that if they keep adding more classes, that the students will finally get it. But if you need help in the first place, you went wrong.
Yeah, well, that is exactly right. So honestly, the only elections have consequences, and you have to take these people out in the electoral process. That's the only thing. That's our ramifications. That's what you can do. I mean, otherwise, it's kind of what we're stuck at. I would say to you, there's other stuff that you need to be aware of. A lot of these schools are going to no class rank, right? They're mm-hmm. getting rid of class rank. They're getting rid of AP courses because AP courses are racist. They're dumbing down the entire system. So you have to be very careful. Glenbard District 87, they're getting rid of consequences if you cheat. Everybody, remote learning also had the issue where if you, the grade you went into with remote learning is the grade that you came out of, at least for mm-hmm. the rest of that first semester. And then a lot of people are doing the, even if you don't turn it in, you get a 50% on everything. So, I mean, this is the entire dumbing down of the school system, a lack of accountability, passing kids through. And you are perfect to speak to it because you can see it firsthand in the classroom. Mm-hmm. So thank you for doing what you're doing.
Thank you.
Perfect. Hi.
I'm Arabella Simmons. I go to Lockport Township High School and still go there. But my question is, when it comes to gender and sexuality, to what degree do you think it should be introduced or talked about in the classroom? And at what age do you think it should be, if any, introduced?
I don't know. I think our generation did just fine with the fifth grade class. Boys go here, girls go there. Here's what puberty's like. I think that was fine. I don't know why we have to have all these conversations surrounding it. I mean, to me, it is one of the most delusional things, and I'm not the only one who says this, is the fact that you're more than one, there's more than two sexes. I mean, I don't know. If we can't agree on that, what else can we agree on? We can't agree on energy policy then, because I can't trust you to be honest. If you're going to change all the abortion laws in the state of Illinois, which they did, to make them gender neutral, so that you don't offend the possibility that a man can actually deliver a child, then I can't help you. You know, I don't see that there's a place for that. If you want to teach, STDs, think that's a great thing to teach, fine. But I think you got to be careful here with all the rest of it. So,
thank you.
Yep.
Hi, my name's Lydia Simpson. I go to CLA in Hopedale. It's a tiny little school. We're working on building the high school building this summer. 15 kids.
Where is this at?
In Hopedale, 30 minutes away from Lincoln, Illinois.
Oh, okay. Yes. Yeah. Where Lincoln is. Okay.
Yeah, it's a tiny little town.
Yes. Okay. Great.
But that's exciting. It's a Christian high school. I don't really have much, if any, political stuff that I don't agree with. We're all fairly conservative. We're all Christian and all that. But we are recently going to have an immigration debate because they're like, we have to debate about something. Let's talk a bit about that. And they're going to put us on teams because we haven't thought that much about it. I'm sorry, I came up here, I want to ask a question, but I feel like everyone's taking the good ones, and I really can't think of anything else.
Well, on immigration, I mean, illegal immigration is illegal immigration. What don't we understand about the word illegal? And if you want to talk about immigration policy, I think that there's a pathway to talk about legal immigration, absolutely, and I would pretty much stick to that.
Yeah. Have you heard of PragerU?
Yes, Prager. Yeah, in fact, Dennis Prager headlined the Illinois Right to Life banquet last Friday. What a phenomenal man. That guy spoke extemporaneously for an hour, and he was wonderful.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Well, one of the Will Witt, you know,
mm-hmm.
Yeah, he went around and he was talking about immigration policy that immigration's being like legalized so much, like anyone from Mexico can come to America with as long as they have a child with them. And when they said that Trump legalized this, everyone was like, this is terrible. This should not happen. They're putting them in these facilities and it is just messed up. They're putting them in these like, yeah. And then when Will Witt said, this is actually from
Obama.
Right. Yeah. And they were like, yeah, this is good. This is a good thing. It's just completely just changed their mind about it just because it was a different person.
Yeah. So I mean, my generation needs to apologize to your generation for sort of the mess that we're leaving behind. And hopefully some of this we can solve with the right leadership in the future, but we've left you quite a mess, right? You've had essentially 2 million illegal immigrants come across in just the last year. They're expecting a surge again this year. So this doesn't get solved anytime soon. It's a really, really difficult issue. I don't know. People want to come to America. It's a great country. We are an exceptional nation. Don't forget about that. Don't forget to stay involved, be involved. And if conservatives just think that we're going to live our life and on our, on, I don't know, 5 acres of land and ignore everything else, it's just not going to happen. They're going to come after you somehow, some way. So again, citizenship is not a spectator sport. And we have all got to be informed about the issues. Thank you so much for having me.